From the Federation point of view, what has been decided is that the Europe is going to be divided into five zones for supporting the integration of the new nodes within the PhilHealth Federation. So there is a north zone which is handled by WIT, composed of the UK and the Ireland and Sweden and Norway, Finland, and okay, there you will have a contact point within WIT organization that will help you out deploying the your node if you are in this zone. Otherwise, there will be another zone on the southwest, which is the handled by Telefonica for Portugal and Spain. A central west, which is handled by Orange, which is, it covers France, Belgium, which is the other one? Netherlands and Luxembourg, and Telefonica Italia will cover the southeast of Europe with the Italy, Austria, Hungary, Serbia, Croatia, Bosnia, Slovenia, Slovakia, Montenegro, Albania, Macedonia, Bulgaria, Romania, Greece, and Turkey. And Deutsche Telekom will cover the Central East Europe with Germany, Czech Republic, Denmark, Poland, Switzerland, Latvia, Estonia, and Lithuania. The federation integration process, it has been started a while ago. We have done the open call for getting the answer for the from infrastructure owners that are willing to enter the PhilHealth Federation. And now, for all of you, you are on the process of deployment, which arrives right before the production. When your node is going to be into production and is going to join the PhilHealth Federation, it's not going to be anymore a new node. It's going to be a node of the Federation. In order to get into this stage, you need to satisfy some constraints, which is to be able to access the Federation core backbone, which is being deployed based on a MDVPN connectivity we are going to discuss. And you for sure need to have the hardware required to deploy the cloud on your infrastructure. If we see the deployment steps, the first thing is to get or maybe in parallel, it would be to have the connectivity to the Federation backbone. This is a really important stage, it can be done in parallel to the hardware procurement. And once you have your hardware, you have to check for the architecture you want to deploy. This is a really important step before going any further. OpenStack provides, I would say, thousands of possibilities of deployment. So it's really important to take a while and think about what you want to do on your infrastructure. There are a lot of the information on the deliverables. You have the deliverable 1.1 that discuss the general architecture, the deliverable 5.1, which gives the architecture from the point of view of the deployment, which you will have the proposal of deployment for OpenStack within a node of PhilHealth. You have two or three possible architectures that are supported by the Federation. I mean, you can do whatever you want as far as it's compatible with the Federation. But keep in mind that when you start deploying the OpenStack, you have a lot of choices, starting from the network to the way you are going to handle the storage and so on and so forth. And if you don't take the time to think about this, you might end up within an architecture that is not compatible or will not be suitable for support. So take attention, ask the questions if you it's not clear for you. Then you will have another deliverable, which is I think is important, is the 5.2, which describes as much as possible the joining of the federation, the IP addressing plan, the DNS, and all technical stuff you need to put into service to get this thing running. Once you have deployed, once you have decided what you want to do, you are going to start to the deployment. Then you will use the IT box and select the architecture you want to deploy, or you're going to do it manually. There is no constraint with this as far, I say, as you deploy an architecture that is compatible. Otherwise, it's going to be hard to get the node to working on the federation. So at this point you have a node that is a standalone node, a cloud that you can handle for yourself and deploy nodes and so on and so forth. Then you're going to start the process of joining the federation. You for sure you need to have already the connectivity to the federation, otherwise this is not going to work. And then you are going to need to start deploying the monitoring. This is an important step because it gives the feedback to the federation about a general feedback about what is the status of the node. Is the first I think is the component that is the easiest one to start deploying. Federated, because it doesn't involve to modify the behavior of your node. Because then you are going to start deploying the instance like the Keystone proxy that is going to be able to for the federation will allow to access your node from a central point of view with a centralized authentication. And you are going to deploy the DCRM component and start using your node from the federation, which means you are going to use the cloud portal as your entry point for the deployment. We will check just on the next slides what this means. But when you are moving from this standalone node to the federation node, you have to keep some information in mind because you will lose some information you might have already introduced on your node. Let's check it. Okay, the first thing. What means to be in the federation? It means that we are going to use the cloud portal of the federation. Your node is going to be listed on this cloud portal. And you are going to be able to deploy your virtual machines, create your policies, and so on and so forth from this portal. The first thing, for sure, is to have an account on this portal. You need to create an account for each user you want to that is able to connect. You will need to have the MDVPN connectivity, sure, and the Keystone proxy connectivity. This is a very important step because this is what is going to link your node in the in terms of authentication to the federation. If you have not performed the Keystone proxy connectivity, your node is not possible. It will not be possible to be on the accessible from the cloud portal. And the DCRM GE should be installed. I think, as far as I know, for the moment we are not using. It's not really required, but you should start installing it. And ITBox will deploy it. Okay, so the Keystone proxy integration. As I say, it provides the access to the Federation IDM, which means when you are going to deploy the Keystone proxy, you are not going to use anymore your authentication from your node. And you are going to use the centralized IDM. It doesn't mean you are going to be able to create as many accounts as you want, but what you have to keep in mind is the account you have already created they are not going to work anymore. The only Keystone proxy instance that is running on the Federation is on Spain. The idea was to have a Keystone proxy running on each node, as you have a Keystone running on each node on your standalone node. The problem with this, we have found some problems with the synchronization of the databases. So in order to allow to continue with the deployment of the file app and not getting blocked with this issue, we have chosen to stick on the Keystone proxy that was already running with the Federation portal. In terms of requirements, you will need to when we add a new infrastructure, we need to update the catalog. Okay, as far as there is one node, only one node now. I do not know if this impacts all nodes at the moment. But if we have an instance running on each node, you have to think that every time we are going to add a new node, it has to be declared on all nodes because the catalog should be the same on the Keystone proxy. So the database is consistent because we will have all the information from all of the nodes, which means we can also have high availability policies based on the declaration of another node, and we go to hit on another node if our Keystone proxy instance is not running. So that's what we can do. We have also another requirement is that we need to configure the firewall policies to allow communication with the remote node, for sure. So if we want to be able to access their Keystone proxy. The impact, this is a very important point. I mean, it's not trivial letting your Keystone proxy and moving to the Keystone to your Keystone instance to move to the Keystone proxy. Once you deploy your platform, you have an admin account, you start deploying some tenants and start working around, and then at some point you say, okay, this is working, I join the Federation. Okay, problem is that all your accounts and all your tenants and all the things you have already done are not lost, but you don't have access anymore. So it's almost the same. The tenants you have deployed, you are able to run them from the command line and do all of the operation because they exist on Nova. But your user, you cannot access them. So you have to prepare your migration, and if you can, either you do not deploy things or important things that you are going to miss before moving to the Federation, or do the necessary to move them to the Federation. So it means maybe doing a snapshot and moving and recreating the instance on something like that, because we don't have an automatic process of moving all what is been already declared to the Federation, and this is important to keep it in mind. If you have this issue, just please contact us. We will try to provide you as much information as we can, but there is not, as far as I know, an easy way to do it. Yeah, Alexandro, yeah. You confirm this?
Yes, okay. Yes.
It's a little problem. Okay, I think this is something I will have some questions about, MDVPN integration. Okay, the idea deploying the MDVPN was to have to secure the backbone, to have some trust on what are about the connectivity between the nodes of the FileApp Federation. This The MDVPN allows to have some kind of privacy and security. It allows also to go a step further, not for the moment, but to try to give us the possibility to work on traffic engineering on the core of the backbone. And when we deploy the MDVPN, we create circuits across the Europe in which we can implement traffic engineering rules like fast rerouting and everything. You can deploy based on MPLS. This is standardized and is interesting from the point of view of the Federation to have something that allows also to discuss across the node with without requiring to implement a lot of security rules. Because the problem when we connect us through the internet is every single flow you have to pay a lot of attention where you are opening it and so on, everything. When you deploy your federation within the MDVPN, you know that only people from other nodes are able to connect. Trusted nodes are able to connect to this MDVPN. So I would not say you don't have to implement security policies, but I guess are a lot easier to implement. And this is something as infrastructure owner you should appreciate, hopefully. And it also ensures that the path that the packets will go across the Europe is going to be trusted. I mean, we are going to pass through Giant. We are not going to go anywhere else because the circuits are handled by Giant. So this is the three big points on deploying the MDVPN. This has not just only advantage, for sure. It has a little bit more of work to prepare the deployment. And we have to agree on the Federation addressing plan. The MDVPN is created on top of the NREN connection. Typically, MDVPN is delivered on a VLAN. You are connected to your NREN. At some point, you have access to internet, and you ask for the MDVPN. Then the NREN typically will propose you two possible choices. Either they are going to provide you a separate link, which is expensive, and you need more interfaces. This doesn't make any sense if you do not have any problem of bandwidth with your actual link. And what is probably they will provide you is they are going to provide you a VLAN. They are going to provide you a peer, an IPv4 peer /30 network, which you are going to connect to your other point of access, and then you are going to build on top of this a BGP peer, which allows you to share the data, the routing information with the other nodes, but also with the NREN. I mean, you have to think that we are the MDVPN. Is a multi-point VPN, which means that it's able to route several destinations. It's able to identify the destination to which a packet has to be routed, because they are building a virtual router on each point of presence, and they are exchanging the path based on MPLS. I don't know which is the standard. They are encapsulating the BGP information with all other NRENs, so they are able to deliver one packet to the destination without creating a dedicated VPN at each time. I mean, how to say? Let me explain this way. We are now five nodes or six nodes that are integrated into the MDVPN. We have started to create the tunnels. We have created the MDVPN with the NREN, and it arrives a new node, the work is going to be done on the new node, on the point of presence to which the new node is hooked to. They are going to build a virtual router, and then all the routes are going to be published to other nodes. So from the point of view of the scalability, this is really interesting, because we just recite the new routes, and we don't care where they come from. They arrive on the BRF of the MDBPN, and we just know we have to publish to send the traffic to the BRF, and it's going to go to the other node. In terms of scalability, this is really, really interesting. You just have to ensure your policy rules, your security rules are compatible. I mean, if you don't open the ports, nothing is going to work. But by default, if you leave the traffic open, but everything is going to work out of the box. Okay, to set up your NDVPN, you should discuss with your NRN, is your primary entry point. They are the ones that are going to tell you whether they provide this service or not. If they do, fine, they are going to give you the planning of the deployment and so on and so forth. If they do not, what you are going to need to discuss with the your federation entry point or representative, here you need to discuss whether the giant is capable of providing a proxy service, which I think is okay for all the nodes that are involved after the open call. They are able to provide a VPN proxy, which will act as if you will be on the MDVPN already, because they are going to proxy the request, and it's Jian who is going to handle the MDVPN at the border with the NREN. So this is another solution, and other way, we have also the possibility to give access through a peer-to-peer VPN, which we are going to discuss a little bit later. So what is the impact of the MDVPN? We need to share the IP address implant. This is important if we are having a VPN and we are on a private address implant. We need to share and to agree on the networks we can use. Okay, what is being done? We have described on D5.2 an addressing plan which allows, I think it's a /20 network, which allows to handle whatever we are going to do now or later within the MDVPN for each node. So each node will take their /20 network and implement it. The thing that you have also to keep in mind is the network you are going to implement or you are going to connect to the MDVPN is the network in which you have the host that works within the Federation service. Your Keystone, your monitoring staff. Okay, this is the network in which you need to connect to the Federation. You do not need to connect the tenants or your OIM network for deployment and so on and so forth. This is up to you. This is described on D5.2, but just to give a small hint, just the administration, the local administration is done on your node, and the addressing plan you are going to deploy for this should be your addressing plan that you are able to address from your management network or whatever, however you have done your architecture service. The tenant network, the project, the use cases should not be on this network neither, because you don't know what people is going to do. You have to think that FileApp is open to everybody, so you don't know potentially what people wants to do in your node. This is something you have to take in mind. So the network for the use cases and other application that will run on your environment should be something that you provide to go outside to internet and don't have any access to your data center or to the MDVPN. Okay. And in case if you are not able to join the MDVPN either by a proxy or by being connected directly by your NREM, you can create a peer-to-peer VPN. The cases, okay, but also can be if the planning from deployment from the NREM is too long, you can also create a temporal peer-to-peer VPN, implement your IP addressing plan as you will be on the MDVPN environment, and then you just have to switch from the peer-to-peer VPN to the MDVPN. This is done in 1 or 2 hours. So you can build all your environment and then just switch from one connectivity to another one. Thank you.